All right, so welcome to this other chapter of Dual System Hot Standby, and we are going to look at it and we want to understand what it is. Previously, we have looked at NAT, which is our network address translation, and now we also want to look at our Dual System Hot Standby and try to understand what it is. Moving forward, with the rapid development of services such as mobile office, online shopping, instant messaging, internet finance, internet education, network carry increasing services and therefore become more important. You wouldn't want to be in the middle of your exam and the internet is off, or the firewall has blocked you, or the firewall, because its power is off, you are unable to access, or you are not able to access the network out and forth. Or imagine you are in the middle of your transaction and you are unable to access your funds simply because the one firewall is off, maybe because of, you know, power shortage or anything that could have happened to it. So that's why you're saying the networks carry increasing services and therefore become more important. So how to ensure uninterrupted network transmission is an issue that needs to be solved urgently during network development. That in case my firewall has an issue, how are we going to make sure that there's no interruption on our network transmission? And this is what we want to look at in this chapter. So dual hot system standby improves reliability. And here we use two firewalls, or two firewalls can be deployed at the egress of our network to ensure that communication between the intranet and our internet is not interrupted. So we want to look at that in this chapter. Could you please mute your microphone if you have some kind of noise in the background? So upon completion of this course, are we together? Let me mute someone. Okay, so we are saying that upon completion of this course, you'll be able to master the technical principles of dual system hot standby. When we talk about hot in computing, what are we referring to? Anyone?
Hot, come again. Hot. Hello.
Yes, please.
Something that is easily changeable, something that you can, I know of a hot swap. So when I relate it to this, I think it's something that you can easily fix, or that can be changed very quickly.
It can be changed very quickly, but keyword, yeah, without turning it off.
Oh yes, yeah,
without turning it off. It is powered on. Yes. You, like you're saying, hot swap, like your computer is running, you can do whatever you want.
Yeah, the computer is running, so you can just, without turning it off, yeah.
Yes. So here, basically, we want to master the principles of dual system hot standby. By hot standby, I mean we have some devices which are powered on and are running, but they are on standby, just for redundancy and also for reliability to ensure that there's no network service interruption. And also master the basic configuration of dual system hot standby upon the completion of this course. So let us look at some of those few slides. So the technical principles of dual host standby. Why dual system hot standby? Okay, let us look at it. So we are saying here that the following figures show a traditional networking mode. Packets exchanged between intranet and our internet users are usually transmitted through our firewall A. This is our firewall A. And if the firewall A is faulty, guess what will happen to our intranet? Our intranet hosts that use firewall A as a default gateway will not be able to communicate with the internet after, and that will affect our communication reliability. Okay, someone has a mic. Let me mute. Okay, and it will affect our communication. All it will lead to communication unreliability. So we have our PCA which wants to communicate to the internet, and they're using our firewall here with the 10.100.10.1 /24 with as a default gateway. But imagine if this guy is off, then that means that this person on our intranet will not be able to communicate to the internet because the firewall will be off. So a security device, like a firewall, is located at a service point to be protected network. This is a to be protected network and the unprotected network, which is the internet. So if only one firewall is deployed at a service connection point, the network services may be interrupted due to a single point of failure, no matter how reliable the firewall can be. So to prevent network service interruptions due to single point of failure, we can deploy two firewalls to form a dual system hot standby. All right, just briefly. So we are saying we shall need two firewalls, or we shall have to deploy the second firewall here to form what we are calling a dual system hot standby kind of mechanism. Okay, clear this. Go to the next screen. So here we have redundancy deployment solution for routers. You know, in routing, if we have a network and we want to make sure that there is reliability or there is redundancy, we can deploy one or two or more routers on our network to form what we are calling redundancy. So in routing network or in a router networking, virtual router redundancy protocol, the VRRP is used for router redundancy. So if we have our routers, we have our PCA here, we have our internet, and we want these guys to be able to communicate. We shall have our router A, router B, and router C. But what we are going to do, we're going to go ahead and configure these routers at a layer two mode, we configure and we make sure they're within the same network segment so that they're able to send packets from each other, forming what we are calling a VRP group. Okay, what we are calling a VRP group. So this is our VRP group of routers, which is having our routers inside. With here we have a master router, which will be actively, transferring or moving our traffic from our intranet to the internet. But these guys are backup routers and they're in standby mode. What is going to happen when we, in our VRP group, we're going to configure a virtual IP address. After configuring our virtual IP address, in case this guy goes off for power reasons or the rat bites the cable, this guy will be in position to take over the master role and we shall still be using our 10.100.10.1 as our default gateway. That way, we don't have to come back to our devices, open maybe your DHCP server, rechange your default gateway to the default gateway of the available router. So we can just configure all this in our VVIP group so that we have our virtual IP address add as our default gateway, and we can have our multiple routers in that group for redundancy purposes, that in case one or more router goes off, as long as we have another router running, we are able to have our services uninterrupted. What we can take note out of this is that this VRRP is introduced, one, to help us take care of the issue of a faulty link on our network, or a faulty link or maybe an interrupted server. It is a basic fault tolerant protocol, and it brings a shorter failure over duration compared with the broadcast packets that depend on dynamic routing protocols. And it also provides link protection even if no dynamic route protocol is available. What we have a group And a group is basically a group of routers in the same broadcast domain to form a virtual router. All these guys form a virtual router, and we assign it with a virtual IP address. So the master router is among the routers in the same VRIP group, and only one router is active, and the active router is the master router. The master router can forward packets with the virtual IP address as the next hop. The backup router, it is not active and it is on standby in our architecture. So the master router periodically sends a hello packet, and how it is able to send a hello packet is in order to determine the status of the master router based on that hello packet. So because of VRIP hello packets are multicast packets, the routers of this group must be interconnected through layer two. Because they're going to be able to send broadcast packets to all those routers to check and see their availability. So when VRIP is enabled, the upstream and downstream devices must have a layer two switching function. Otherwise, the backup routers cannot receive the hello packets because it's sent by the master router. And if the networking requirement is not met, then we won't be able to use our VRIP in this case. So moving forward, let us look at the application of VRIP in multi-zone firewall networking. To provide dual system hot standby for multiple zone on a firewall, what do we need on a firewall? So what do we need? You must configure multiple VRIP groups. For us to be able to have multiple zones, we must configure multiple VRIP groups. So if multiple zones on a firewall require the hotspot standby, you must configure multiple VRIP groups on each firewall. And as firewalls are stateful firewalls, they require the forward and reverse packets to pass through the same firewall. To meet this requirement, the status of VRIP groups on a firewall must be the same. That is, all VRIP groups on the firewall must be in the master state so that all packets can pass through the firewall and other firewall functions as the backup firewall. We have the default zones. We talked about them earlier. Maybe I can just mention them again. And we said these firewalls, someone is calling the success. Saying that we have some default zones already configured. One is a trust, the other is DMZ. We talked about these zones in the previous few slides. And by default, they have their configuration numbers. Trust is 80, and DMZ is 50, and our untrust zone is 5. And the firewall will trust this zone depending on the priority number. So the higher the priority number, the more trustworthy the zone is. And we said these numbers cannot be modified or changed. Remember, in the previous slides, cannot be modified or changed. But there's also another zone inside our firewall, which we are calling the local zone. And since because it's within the firewall and it is trusted, it has a 100 level, okay? So that is a level that it has. Let me clear that from my screen. So we are saying that for us to have multiple zones on our firewall, you must configure multiple VRIP groups. So we have VRIP group one, we have VRIP group two with a virtual IP address of .20, this one of .10.1. So with this, we have our firewalls. Because remember, our firewalls in nature, they perform at stateful inspection. Who remembers what stateful inspection is? We talked about it in the previous chapter. Anyone, you can just say mic check and tell me. Anyone? Come on, guys, anyone?
Mic check, I think.
Yes, please.
deals with the packet session, the session, and then segment check, then permit. It's the steps that it takes to permit a given packet.
Okay. And the subsequent packets, as long as there's a session, the subsequent packets will not go through that entire process of filtering and, you know, and establishing the connection for the subsequent packets. And by default, our firewalls operate at the stateful inspection, using the stateful inspection mechanism. So what will happen if this guy sends a packet, it goes through here, a session is created, but because of reason ABCD, this firewall link breaks. And when it's trying to send back the packet, it breaks. But remember, you have our redundancy. You have another group and it sends through the firewall backup. But remember, this guy does not have the session of up there, meaning this packet is going to be discarded. So this is one of the challenge that we are already seeing with this. But basically what happens is that we have a VIP group, we have a virtual IP address, and for redundancy, this one connects to that interface, and this one also connects to that interface, this one connects to that interface, and that one connects at that interface. So,
Samuel.
Yes, please.
I just need some clarity on the previous slide. Yeah? If these configurations are, can't these configurations be done on the AC other than on the firewall?
Can they be done on the
access controller?
Yes, 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 yes.
Other than on the firewall.
And some, remember the firewall, what device is on the egress of your of your network? In most cases it will be your firewall, isn't it?
Okay.
Isn't it?
Yes.
And what device are you going to use as your AC? Are you getting my point?
I'm picking you.
Yes. So we are saying the disadvantage of VRRP, remember we said VRRP is a protocol that we're going to use for routing. In a firewall is as follows, that in the traditional VRRP mode, the status of the master firewall cannot be consistent with that of the backup firewall. Why? We already said that we have our different packets. In case this packet comes through this and goes to PC4, and in return, it finds that a session is created, right? The first packet and the subsequent packets are just processed accordingly. But in case a packet wants to come and this guy is off for some reason, and it wants to use the backup firewall, it's not going to be in the same status as the master firewall. And we shall have issues and the packet will be discarded. So let us look at how we can try and get rid of, and get rid of that problem and how we can be able to solve that problem. So let us use multi-zone. Let us look at the use of VRP for firewall in multi-zone backup. So to ensure switchover consistency of all VRP groups, the VRP group management protocol, we use this protocol, the VGMP. The VRP group management protocol is developed based on VRRP. And we have our different groups, and we have our VM group, and we have also our VM group. And these guys always communicate and send hello packages to each other. Why? To establish, and this guy will always get the backup of that person. So the requirements for this application, you need a VRP consistency, and also you need session table status backup. So multiple groups on a firewall can be added to a VGMP group, which manages the VRP groups in a unified manner. VGMP controls the status switchover of a VRP groups in a unified manner, thus ensuring consistency status of our VRP packet. Yeah, my screen. So basic principle of VGMP, if a VGMP group on a firewall is in active state, all VIP groups in VGMP are in active state. So the same applies with standby. So the firewall in VGMP active state regularly tests the peers running peer statuses, including the priority VIP member status numbers by sending hello packets. It will send hello packets to all the guys in the groups. We have our VGMP active, and then we have our standby. So they send hello packets to ensure that these guys are okay. Then after, it is able to send also the session table backups and that. So you can specify the group status to determine the active or the standby firewall. And also the initial VIP group priority on our firewall. And the next generation firewall is usually 45,000. I won't get into those details. Let me move. So status, management of VGMP, status consistency management. Here, whenever the status of VGMP group changes, the VGMP group must be notified of the change. And the group determines whether to allow the master backup switchover of the group. If the status switchover is necessary, then the VGMP group instructs all its VIP groups to perform the switchover. Therefore, after the VIP group is added to a VGM group, the status cannot be switched separately from the group. So we have a group that controls the switchover of the VIP groups. And then now we have the preemption management. And with the preemption management, the VIP group are capable of preemption. Like maybe the other host was off and then he comes back online. How do we migrate back? After what delay do we go back to our master or our active VGMP group? So here they have it is capable of doing preemption, and if the fault master firewall recovers, so the priority of the firewall, therefore the firewall must be, therefore the firewall can become the master firewall again through preemption. So the preemption function of the group is similar to that of VIP groups. If the faulty VIP group is in a VGMP recovers, then the priority will be restored to its original value, depending on how you configured your architecture. Okay, so we look at the basic concepts of the HRP. So the HRP is a Huawei redundancy protocol, and it backs up dynamic status data and key configuration commands between firewalls. It's a Huawei redundancy protocol, and it backs up dynamic status data and key configuration commands in a firewall. We have our different groups, we have our session table. What is going to happen? This guy is going to, if you're using the HRP, it's going to get all those details and it will back them up. So the HRP module provides the basic data backup mechanism and transmission function. And each application module collects the data that needs to be backed up by the module and submits it to the HRP module, which the HRP module will send the data to the corresponding module of the peer firewall. So the application module passes the data submitted by the HPM module and adds it to the dynamic running data pool of the firewall. So here we have our backup data, and our backup data is usually our TCP or UDP session tables. We have our server map entries. We have our server map entries. We have our dynamic blacklist. What's the dynamic? Could you please mute your microphones? I don't want to keep muting them. Because I keep muting and you keep unmuting. It's a bit disorganizing. All right, so we're looking at the dynamic blacklist. What happens is that if you have configured the dynamic blacklist and you know some IP addresses who have been blacklisted, that you know they are not safe, maybe the hacker tried to hack. So it will also back up all those information and it will share them across the different firewalls. And no PT entries, and also the ARP entries. There's also the backup direction. The backup direction is basically the firewall with the active GVMP group backups that the required data to the peer. So backup data is done at the master firewall. And the backup channel is basically the ports that directly interconnect the two firewalls that are used as backup channel, which is most sometimes called the heartbeat link. So the VIP uses this channel for communication, the VGMP. So heartbeat interfaces, let us look at the heartbeat interfaces. So heartbeat interfaces, we are saying that we have two firewalls exchange backup data through the heartbeat interfaces over the heartbeat link. We said, what is the heartbeat link? Who remembers? It is the backup channel, right? And there are ports that interconnect the two firewalls that are used as the backup channel. It's what we are calling the backup link. So a heartbeat interface must be independent interface with an IP address. Must be an independent interface with an IP address, and it can be a physical interface, such as a gigabit Ethernet interface or a logical Ethernet trunk. Ethernet trunk is just a bundle of different Ethernet links, right? Which you can put together for redundancy and of course for speed, link aggregation, right? Link aggregation. So it can either be through the link aggregation, the Ethernet trunk, or it can be on an independent interface, but they must have an IP address and it must be an independent interface. So usually data backup counts for about 20% to 30% of service traffic, and you can determine the number of Ethernet trunk interfaces based on the amount of data that you want to backup. Let us look at the status of heartbeat interfaces. These are the different statuses we have. Invalid, like you hear the word invalid, it means that the physical status is up and the protocol status is down. So the local heartbeat interface is incorrectly configured. The cables are up, the status is down, but this one is incorrectly configured. That's why this peer, when it tries to communicate, this is the heartbeat direction. When the peer tries to communicate and send that, we'll see that this guy, the physical is up, but the protocol which are going to use is down. So let us look at the down status. Also down, here with down, the physical and both the protocol statuses of the heartbeat interfaces are down. The peer is going to try and communicate. There's no physical, maybe the cable is not communicated, and also the protocols are not communicated. Yeah. So it will be peer, it will be down totally. When it comes to peer down basically means, even so, the local heartbeat interface continues sending the heartbeat in the link direction packets and send expects to resume the heartbeat link when the peer interface is brought up. So if the peer is down, this guy will keep on sending interfaces, but the status will be, hey, the person you're trying to reach is down, okay? The person you're trying to reach is down, much as it will keep on sending the interfaces. And then another one is ready. And with ready, basically the physical and the protocol statuses are both up and the configurations are set correctly. So the local heartbeat interfaces receive the heartbeat link detection reply packets from the peer heartbeat interface. In this case, a firewall sets the status of the local heartbeat interface to local, indicating that it is ready to send and receive heartbeat packets. This one is just like you hear the word ready. So we also have running. So running is when multiple heartbeat interfaces are in a ready state, and the interface firewall sets the status to the first configured one to running. So if one interface is already in a ready state and the sets it to running, the running interface is used to send the HERP heartbeat packets and data packets and link detection packets and the VGMP packets and consistency check packets. So these are some of the statuses that you can, some of the different statuses that you will be able, that you can look at. So we go ahead and we look at backup modes of hot standby. We have different backup modes. We have the automatic backup. with automatic backup, that's your clear the word automatic. By default, automatic backup is enabled on our firewalls to automatically backup our configuration commands and in real time, and also status information regularly. So this backup method applies to various hot standby networks. After it is enabled, every time you execute a command that can be backed up on a firewall, the firewall immediately backs up to the other firewalls as well. So after also it is configured, the active device periodically backs up status information that can be backed up to the standby device. Therefore, the status information of active device is not immediately backed up after its connection or creation, but instead the information is backed up on the standby device around after like 10 seconds after its creation. Okay, so types of sessions cannot be backed up in automatic backup mode, like the sessions created after traffic. Destinate, please mute your microphone. Okay, TCP have open connections. Those ones are not backed up, and sessions created by UDP first packets, but not matching subsequent packets. Those ones are also not backed up. So the other one, we have a manual backup. With manual backup, just excuse me briefly. So we were looking at manual backup, and we're saying manual batch backups needs to be triggered by the configuration of the manual batch backup command. The backup starts immediately and applies to scenarios where manual backup is required when configuration of two devices are asynchronous. So after the manual backup command is executed, the designated active device immediately synchronizes its configuration commands to our standby devices. And also the designated active device immediately synchronizes the status information to our active devices. We also have quick session backup. And with quick session backup, when the forward and reverse paths are inconsistent on a load balancing network, inconsistent forward and reverse paths may occur on load balancing networks because both devices are active and able to forward packets. So if status information is not synchronized in a timely manner, reverse packets may be discarded. So they do not match any sessions, so causing service interruption. Therefore, that's why we need quick session backup is required by a firewall to backup status information in real time to make sure that subsequent packets are not discarded. So for timely synchronization, this function synchronizes status information but not configuration information. Its synchronization of configuration commands can be undertaken by using our automatic commands. So what quick session does, it basically looks at the status information, right? What is a session, you know, our session and our server mapping entries. And then automatic sync of firewall configuration after restart is the last one. So here we have automatic synchronization of active or standby firewall configuration after restart. So in a hot standby network, if one firewall is restarted, the other firewall processes all services during a restart. In this period, the firewall that processes the service may have the configurations added or deleted or modified. So to ensure that the active and standby firewall have the same configuration, so after a firewall is restarted, the configurations are automatically synchronized from the firewall, from the firewall that processes the services. So only configurations that can be backed up on this configuration are such as security policies, NAT policies, and configurations that cannot be backed up, such as the OSPF and the BGP, remain unchanged. So configuration status can take up to 1 hour and subject to amount of configuration. So during the synchronization, you may not be allowed to execute any configuration commands that can be backed up between firewalls. So these are the different backup modes on our firewall. So let us look at the basic configuration of this. So we have a basic configuration. So when upstream and downstream services on a firewall work at layer 3 and connect to layer 2 devices, configure VIP groups on the service interfaces so that the VGMP group can monitor layer 3 service interfaces through VIP groups. Okay, and this is just the illustration. So in this kind of system, in our system hot standby, firewalls usually work in routing mode, and the downstream switches separately connect to the firewalls through two links. In normal cases, a firewall has the active acts as the active firewall, and if the uplink or downlink of a firewall goes down, then the firewall B becomes the active firewall, and switch traffic is transmitted through firewall B. So this is our firewall B backup. This is our master active firewalls, and we have our configurations, and these guys are connecting at layer 2. These interfaces are on layer 3. So in case this guy goes off, because of our VGMP and using the VRRP technology, this guy will take over, and it has all the session and everything backed up and shared with him. So we'll take over and we'll continue to process our packets. Okay, so how to configure the interface? Basically, you just go into your server and you save your IP, and then you type in these commands. You can go through these things. I don't want to type them there. And after it specified, the VIP group is added to the active standby group modes. We can add up to 255 VRRP groups. All up to 255 VRP groups can be configured on each common physical interface or gigabit Ethernet. Kindly also take note of that. I've seen it a lot in questions. Okay, so proceeding to configuring HCRP, on the command line. Specify the heartbeat interface. You go to HCRP interface, and then you type in this command. You look at it, interface type. Basically, you're specifying the type, and then interface number. You specify the number. It's either remote. You put the IP address. If you're also going to use IPv6, you also specify the IPv6 network. So then after, you go and say HCRP enable. After enabling, you say HCRP standby config enable. This one enable the function of configuring standby device, and then enable the function to automatically backing up commands and status information. So you say HCRP auto sync, and then you specify the configuration and then the status, connection status. So HCRP mirror session enable if you want to enable the quick session backup. Remember, we talked about quick session backup. What does quick session backup do? It was a part of those four session modes. We said, what does it do? What does it back up? Remember, we have two things we back up. We have configurations, and we also have the status information. What does this guy do? Quick session. Class, are we still together, or we have lost each other along the way?
Configurations.
It backs up. No, we said quick status helps us. Quick session helps us to back up the status information.
Okay.
And the configuration files can be taken care of by either the automatic or the manual. Okay. All right. So
by the auto sync.
Yes. So let us look at VIP configuration example. This is just an example. If you want to get off time, you can go and go through these codes, yeah? And you try out this example on the notes. I already shared the notes. So you try, you go and configure on group one on your USG firewall. So after you have opened your firewall, don't forget to type in the sys command to take you into the system view. So you go to the system view, and then you type in interface gigabit Ethernet. So that you go to this interface. When you go to that interface, you go ahead and you'll be inside this interface. You assign it interface address. You assign it an IP address of 10.10 and class C forward slash or subnet mask of 255.255.0. And then you go ahead and you create a VIP, VIP ID, which is 1, VIP IP, which is 1.1.1.1. And this is the subnet mask. And then you say active. So you can go ahead and try out those commands, right? And then you also go on, you have two firewalls. You go on firewall B, you as well as go ahead and create that, pass on those commands and see what happens. Yeah. Okay. So HCIP configuration example is just basically an HCIP configuration example. You say it's HCIP enable, HCIP mirror session enable. Then HCIP interface gigabit Ethernet. You specify the interface. Remember, I said it has to be an active interface with also an IP address. So you can go ahead and also try out that example. So viewing the status, if you want to view, you can just say display HCIP interface gigabit Ethernet on the Ethernet. You configured it, and then you'll be able to see the different status of your. Of your VRP group, eh? You'll be able to see the group is active, the set is active, the virtual IP is that, the virtual MAC address is that, the primary IP is that, the priority. You'll be able to see those other different configurations of your VRP group. Okay, so viewing VRP status on the command. If you want to view the status of active firewall, you say display HIRP state, and then it will show you the active firewalls on your topology or on your network. The same applies if you want to configure on a web UI. I'm not really going to go through them because they are a bit direct forward. As long as you can access your firewall, let me see here if I can access, I don't know if it is on. It is admin HCIA at 123. So it is on. Let me go ahead and permit HTTP. So I'll say service manage HTTPS permit. Service. Oh, I'm supposed to first go into my interface. So I'll say interface gigabit 0.0.0. And then I'll permit my HTTP. And then I come back to my browser. And refresh. And refresh and wait for it to connect. Yes, I am. Yes. Like around 11:40 or midday. Okay. So we shall look at that later on. I think because I've been changing networks, so I need to first look at my adapters, then I'll be able to access my file. Okay. So just go to system, high availability, dual host system standby. Basically, just click on it and then you click on edit to configure the system. And then after you click on edit, you check your active standby, you make sure it is active, proactive R preemption, you also enable it and you give it the interfaces. So if you are configuring the standby firewall, you also go into your firewall and then you enter its virtual IP address and click on VRP. As you can just follow those, they're a bit direct forward. Then you can be able to see the details of the historical switchover and to see the hot standby status information. Still, you go to your system, you go to your page, and then you view the running mode role, and then you say group status, and then you'll be able to see the group status. So this brings us to the quiz of HRP enables the active firewall to synchronize all configurations and informations to the standby firewall. Therefore, the configurations and information are still available after firewall restart. As a result, no information needs to be configured on the standby firewall, true or false?
It's true.
It's true, yes. Why do you think it's true?
Because we said HRP is Huawei Redundancy Protocol, backing up dynamic status data and key configuration commands between firewalls.
Okay. Okay, that is very true. But remember, after the restart, we said some commands and configurations could have been made. Sometimes you restart a firewall because there are some key commands, like let's say you have updated or you have done something on your active firewall. So that means after the restart, still it will synchronize the information, isn't it? After the restart, it will synchronize the information. Yes. And we say during the time of synchronizing, but what it is synchronizing? It's synchronizing its information and configuration to our standby firewall, isn't it?
Yes.
And that's why we say during this time, actually we cannot even pass any other commands that can be backed up in the firewall. So meaning after the restart, still also, we need information to be configured with a standby firewall from our firewall, which has been restarted. Or we need to synchronize that what is here is what is on our master, or what is on our master is what is on our standby. Okay. So this statement, as a result, no information needs to be configured with a standby firewall. This makes it false. I don't know if I'm clear.
Okay, I get it.
But
sir,
you are very correct. You get it now?
Yes.
So our answer is false. Now let us look at the next question. Which of the following protocol is used to control a switchover of all VRP groups in the firewall dual system hot standby networking? Which of the following protocols is used to control the switchover of VRP groups in the firewall dual system hot standby networking?
A.
It is?
A.
It is A. That is perfect. Because even A stands for itself, for VRV, VRRP group management protocol. Okay. So this is to manage that protocol. All right. So that brings us to the end of this chapter. We have looked at those different things. And thank you for being part of that chapter.